Let me describe the impact on you. The stress-related health harm. We're going to define bullying as a stressor. A stressor is an external event, a source of distress. Okay, mini tutorial on stress. People that want to say stress is good are halfway accurate. Because when they mean stress is good, they mean stress is exhilarating, stress is stimulating, stress is wonderful to get people excited. It gets them up in the morning and they're willing to go on to their job because they're excited about it, but it carries a level of stress. That's called eustress, E-U-stress. But distress is negative stress and the body hates distress. The human stress response is triggered in response to stressors that trigger distress. Distress leads to stress-related diseases. It isn't stress that kills, it's stress-related diseases that kill. And that's why it's so stinking dangerous. Let's take a look at some indicators of stress. I'm not going to read them to you. I'm just going to let you read them. And the first is a list of physical indicators. Next, cognitive or mental indicators, disruption of your thought processes. Third, emotional indicators. Sometimes emotion is called affect, A-F-F-E-C-T. So they're called affective disorders and things. So disturbances of your affect or disturbances of your emotions or moods. Notice anger is on this page. Anger is one characteristic that seems to accompany trauma. And that trauma, the traumatized individuals, you may very much want to help. Or if you are traumatized yourself, you need help and you seek help. But we tend to push those helpers away with the anger. And the anger that accompanies trauma scares them. And that's always problematic. It prevents the help from getting delivered. So when we start to look at the health impact, the sort of the gateway system of your body that reacts to stressors is the cardiovascular system. And that gateway is hypertension, high blood pressure, which is a silent killer. It is asymptomatic. You don't feel it usually. And again, it has to be detected. So unless you're a person that uses a blood pressure cuff for a related heart disease, you would have no reason to believe this is coming on. So that can delay your recognition for a long time. I want to talk to you about the neurological changes in just a second here. First, because that's the newest stuff. The newest illustration of stress-related impact and harm to people's lives. But one of the great golden oldies is gastrointestinal effect, how the small and large intestine have a war between themselves when the body is stressed, when the person is stressed, distressed, and they suffer colitis or what's called irritable bowel disorder. The percentages here are the numbers in this checklist that I used on an online survey of targets. These are how many targets said they suffered these symptoms. Sleep disorders, more difficult to fall asleep, delayed sleep, and reduced quality of sleep without REM. So that the distressed person is fatigued, more and more fatigued at work, more likely to make physical and or mental errors depending upon the nature of the work. So if it's physical, they're going to be more likely to suffer injuries. And if it's mental, the type of work, then they're going to create more errors, which then gives fodder to the bully's lie that you're incompetent. But it's the fatigue that's accounting for it. There's musculoskeletal problems with either the onset of fibromyalgia or its exacerbation and chronic fatigue syndrome, which now the Institute of Medicine has finally acknowledged is indeed a legitimate syndrome, and it's a problem. Skin disorders, psoriasis, body rashes, all kinds of problematic stress-related breakouts, migraine and tension headaches, diabetes, clearly cancer, though it's not a direct line between stress and cancer, but through the suppression of the immune system and the interference with T cells, what happens, the escalation of T cells, what happens is people will develop cancer. This Wegener's granulomatosis is a very rare disease, but as you may know, we do our training for professionals 4 or 5 times a year called Workplace Bullying University. And we had a nursing professional, I think she was, attend. And when I got to this list, she told me about her disease, which was totally stress-related. I'd never heard of it, so I definitely added it to the list just as an illustration. I met a real-life person with a real-life, rare stress-related disease. I want to talk about the neuroscience, though. These are the newest breakthroughs, basically because they've come up with a tool to measure brain activity, to tell you which regions of the brain are activated, which association areas in the brain are being used at a particular time to process information, so they can pinpoint the source of feelings and thoughts and experiences, and as never before, using the MRI machine. So if you've ever had an MRI test, magnetic resonant imaging test, then you know. And they put a device over a person's head, they can show a video, they can put headphones on them and send them audio stuff, they can put a little decision-making keypad on their chest and they can select decisions and make choices while they're in the MRI. See, the MRI traces oxygen, where the oxygen goes, where the blood goes, and those are the areas that light up, show you areas of the brain that are being used. So having said that, let's talk about a brain cell for just a second, a neuronal cell, a neuron, pictured there on your right. They are lined up one to another with the dendrites being by the nerve endings of the other nerve that it's adjacent to. Now, they don't touch. They have this very tiny, tiny, tiny gaps called synapses. And then there are chemicals that send across the bonding agent, the message. And they're called neurotransmitters. And that's how basically the electricity is done in the brain. And then the amassing of millions and millions of the firings of these cells are going to light up. All right. Two properties happen to the brain when the brain is stressed. Number one, it's atrophy. Well, one happens when it's stressed and one when it's de-stressed. Certain regions of the brain are going to be sensitive to changes in the synapse when certain chemicals flood the brain. Stress-related hormones called cortisol and ACTH and serotonin flood the brain when you are stressed. And that interferes, that gets in that those synapses, and then it interferes with the transmission nerve to nerve. And it changes the firing patterns, and it changes, therefore, your experiences. A stressed brain is not a normal brain. Primarily, the principle I want to talk to you about here is atrophy. The stressed brain is going to have shrunken dendrites. They're going to shorten. Now, the whole cell may die. But primarily, when the dendrites shorten, that region of the brain literally shrinks in volume. It gets smaller. And with that reduction in size comes the loss of whatever behavior that region of the brain was responsible for. For instance, if it's memory, one of the primary regions is the hippocampus. The hippocampus is in the midbrain region of the brain. It's a more primal structure. We have these three different layers, if you will, under the cortex. The cortex is the highest level, but in the midbrain, the former limbic system, that's where the hippocampus and the amygdala dwell. Amygdala regulates our emotionality and our moods, plus it plays a key part in learning, and the hippocampus is our memory storage device. It's the primary, but there are other regions in the brain. When the hippocampus shrinks, we lose the ability to remember past events, past incidents, long-term stored memories, because we can't relocate them. In other words, we can't retrieve long-term memories. Plus, we, under stress, the stressed brain fails to lay down new memories. So a stressed hippocampus is going to make that person appear to have less memory. To have less memory is to appear less competent, less intelligent. So the way it maps out, as I told you, is the constant critic bully gets you behind closed doors and hammers you over a series of months through weekly meetings or nearly daily meetings, God forbid, that you're stupid, you're incompetent, you're stupid, and you know it's wrong, but over time your stressed brain is actually structurally changing and the hippocampus is shrinking and you're losing your memory ability. And when they put you on a PIP, a performance improvement plan, as punishment, you, a veteran employee, are now reverted back to considered to be a newbie, a probationary employee. Your performance decline is going to absolutely convince them objectively that you are no longer intelligent. But that's because they changed your brain. We use the phrase lightly, get inside someone's head. Well, this is an invasion, an unspeakable invasion, an unconscionable invasion. They're literally changing our brains, and they shouldn't have the right to do it. And that explains your performance deficit because of hippocampal shrinkage. You can look that up. The second principle that's right here on this slide is plasticity. And here's the good news. If you can turn off the stressor, get away from the bully and all the negativity that was surrounding the bully, and be given restored psychological safety in your workplace, then what can happen is the brain has its own regeneration ability to restore that volume called plasticity. And that's beautiful. And you will recover and your memories will be restored. The memories didn't go anywhere. Your access to the memories did, your ability to retrieve them. So that's the good news. Bad news, atrophy. Good news, plasticity. But only if and only if you get rid of the stressor. You must eliminate the stressor. Stress management is basically trying to convince yourself that your own perception of the world is wrong. And that has some short-term advantages, but not like getting rid of the stressor. It must be eliminated. The employer must do that. I'm going to just show you this two more things on stress research that are fascinating. Here's the prefrontal cortex, cortical region of your brain. This is inside your brain. This is a sliced version, and I made it white. It's not white. But between the limbic system and the higher cortex is the cingulate gyrus. And here's a sliced brain. Hope that's not yours. I had never heard of this structure called the insula, particularly the right insula, which is buried there in the brain. It turns out it's involved in your ability to maintain relationships, which is fascinating. I don't know how they've been able to identify that, but it's just fascinating. So from this human study, what we see here in this 2012 study is the medial prefrontal cortex, if it's atrophied, and there's an MRI scan showing a particular size, and compared to somebody else, a person who had been exposed to traumatic life events has a atrophied medial prefrontal cortex, an atrophied anterior cingulate, and an atrophied right insula, they lead to a smaller gray matter volume area there. And those three regions, they combine to lead to this following behavioral vulnerability. More likely to experience depression, addictions, anxiety, and to have less socially supportive relationships. Now, a word about that. We know from the stress research guru Robert Sapolsky that social support is the number one stress buster for human beings. To be denied social support, another human being telling you to not believe the lies, telling you they love you, it's all well and good to have pets, but we still need other human beings in our circle. We need social support. Isolation stresses great magnifier. It worsens it, exacerbates it. But social support can overcome the isolation and it can help overcome the stress. It can push toward plasticity in the brain, as we're seeing right here in these things. Now, one more. I want to show you how stress affects your life at the cellular level, not in your brain, but in your chromosomes. And for this, this woman named Elizabeth Blackburn won the Nobel Prize in 2009. And she's talking about your DNA chromosome here in blue. And she discovered many, many years ago, along with other scientists, these little protective caps on the end of the chromosome called telomeres. And we need to have DNA cellular replication throughout our lives to stay alive, to stay young, but also to stay alive. And when the cells die, we age. And that's how we eventually wind down our lives. There's no more cellular replication. Well, stress plays a role in how fast or how quickly we age. Because if you look at this picture, the telomeres, the healthy telomeres here on this left side, look like cotton balls in that, are protecting the strands of the DNA chromosomes so they can reproduce. But when you look at the right side picture, stress interferes with an enzyme that leads to the telomeres erosion. And when they erode like that, it's like taking the plastic tip off of a shoestring and having it unravel. And then the DNA cell unravels, it's going to die or fail to replicate, and therefore we get older faster. Stress makes us age faster. This is another biological underpinning of something that seems obvious to us, but that's why you have to avoid stress. I want to lead you to this fine book called Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers, and there's the author, Wild Man Robert Sapolsky at Stanford. It's part self-help and it's part science book. He writes for sciences, science journals, medical journals. He's a great researcher of cortisol, the stress hormone, primary stress hormone. Read about cortisol. We don't have time to get into it, but get this book. It's written for you. It'll just appeal to you and give you all kinds of advice and tips. Some of you have been exposed for a great deal of time to stressors and you're overwhelmed. You got overwhelmed. That's what PTSD is. Post-traumatic stress disorder is the inability to suddenly rebound from the distress. Your system is done. You just can't do anything. These are the four symptoms of PTSD. You may have the symptoms and experience trauma-like problems, but not necessarily have PTSD because the diagnosis of PTSD is very difficult to obtain. Therapists, psychiatrists can do that according to the DSM. But the DSM is a book that still relies upon a simplistic definition of PTSD as being a single life-threatening event, whereas you've had several life-threatening events. Your stress, your trauma is cumulative trauma. They don't yet have cumulative trauma in the DSM, so you don't get that diagnosis. But you do have trauma-like symptoms. Intrusive thoughts, the first category. Those are the stereotypical nightmares of PTSD that come back at unannounced times and invade your cognitive space and you just overtake your life at that moment. Persistent avoidance of parking places, of stores, of places where you used to go with your friends who are no longer your friends, of the workplace itself. You can't go there anymore without triggering the same gut-churning feelings of trauma and scared and anxiety. Negative cognitions and moods. This is the dark side of PTSD. It's shame, guilt, inability to feel positive, flat affect. Remember I told you about affect before. Feeling estranged from others and dissociative amnesia. Dissociation is where you were so hurt by a particular event, you cannot remember all the details because your brain knew it was so horrific that it had to take you to a different place, to dissociate from your then current situation to protect you. And that can happen even in bullying. You can see 14% have that. Arousal and reactivity is the hypervigilance, the being easily startled, the irritability, the aggression. Folks with PTSD are not murderers. The press, they don't understand anything as complex as PTSD. The people who do understand PTSD, people at Veterans Administration hospitals, because PTSD is a war wound. Why are you getting that? You're just a worker. Well, that means for you, as a bully target, your workplace was a war zone. Here's a wonderful workbook, very practical book that you can pick up by Mary Beth Williams, the PTSD workbook, to help you work through this. The thinking on PTSD is you don't recover until, you don't even have a chance to have recovery until at least 1 year from the complete cessation of all stressful activities. And for some people that doesn't end. I think we need to start thinking of trauma as recovering. One is in recovery, in recovering status, and never fully recovered, because one can be easily re-traumatized.